Let's start.
Today we are going to discuss about diseases of skeletal muscles. Diseases of skeletal muscles. So these are the group of diseases. But in your objective, don't worry. Only the red one is
okay.
In your objective.
Okay.
Others is just the names. So these are the groups of diseases. Just close that door. Okay, these are the groups: denervation, atrophy, muscular atrophy, ion channel myopathies, congenital myopathies, myopathies associated with inborn errors, inflammatory myopathies, toxic, and diseases of neuromuscular junction. In this, in your objective, only the muscular dystrophy, inflammatory, and neuromuscular junction diseases are included. Before starting, first you should know what is the pathology in the muscle you will see in all these dystrophies or atrophy. First one is segmental necrosis. I think histology of skeletal muscle is over.
Yes.
You know what is the structure of skeletal muscle.
Yes.
So segmental means if the length of muscle is there, only a part of that muscle is necrosed. That is called segmental necrosis, destruction of portion of the length of myocyte. So, and you know, in inflammation, whenever there is destruction, what will happen? Inflammatory cells will come. So the phagocytes, macrophages, they will enter that area and they will engulf, phagocytose the muscle. So this segmental necrosis is destruction of a portion of the length of a myocyte followed by myofagocytosis as macrophages infiltrate the region. Loss of muscle fiber in time leads to extensive deposition of collagen. Why there is collagen deposition? Because this is chronic inflammation. Whenever chronic inflammatory cells come, it heals by
fibrosis.
So fibrosis is nothing but after fibrosis there is collagen deposition. Okay. Second is vacuolation. Vacuolation, you know, there will be vacuoles inside the muscle. Alteration in structural proteins or organelles and accumulation of intracytoplasmic deposit. Regeneration. Regeneration means whenever it is a repair. Whenever a precursor cell proliferate and reconstitute the destroyed portion of fiber, regenerating portion of muscle has large nuclei, prominent nucleoli. And fiber hypertrophy, you know, the hypertrophy, the same is for here. Whenever any person he do exercise or any pathologic condition, here you will see one condition where there is hypertrophy. So this occurs in response to increased load. So these are the features which you will see. Okay, necrosis, vacuolation, regeneration, hypertrophy. So first group is inherited disorder. What do you mean by inherited?
It is present
in the genes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is X-linked muscular dystrophy. What is X-linked? X chromosome is involved. So the gene is present in the X chromosome. So X chromosome means it comes from X chromosome means it comes from mother. So females are carriers.
Yes.
And usually males are affected.
Okay.
So there is a protein which is called dystrophin. You should remember this.
Yes.
So there is mutation in dystrophin. So whenever there is mutation in dystrophin, these muscular dystrophies occurs, inherited disorder. And in this group, the most important is two. One is Duchenne muscular dystrophy and second is Becker. Duchenne and Becker. Yeah? No, this is dystrophy. What do you mean by dystrophy? Dystrophy means disorder. Okay?
Yes.
Did you discuss skeletal muscle contraction?
Yeah.
How they contract?
Actin bind to myosin.
Actin bind to myosin, all this, you know, the whole thing. In this, there is one protein called dystrophin. Okay?
Yes.
The dystrophin, it attaches at one end to actin, and another end, what is this? All these are transmembrane proteins.
Connects the actin with the...
Yeah. It indirectly connects the inner. This is extracellular. This is... So you see this, dystrophin and intracellular protein forms an interface between cytoskeletal proteins and a group of transmembrane proteins. The dystroglycans and sarcoglycans. These are transmembrane proteins. Okay? These are transmembrane proteins and these are cytoskeletons. So dystrophin, it forms an interface. Whenever this interface is formed, there will be smooth contraction of muscle. Whenever there is problem in this dystrophin, the contraction will not be smooth. Okay? So this transmembrane protein has interaction with extracellular matrix, including the laminin protein. So whenever there is the problem in this contraction, what will happen? The patient, he is unable to contract the muscle properly. And once he want to do it, it's very difficult for him. So he will do extra work. So whenever a patient do extra work on muscles, what will happen? They will be hypertrophy. But this hypertrophy is not the hypertrophy of weightlifters, athletes like that. This is due to pathology. So this is called pseudo hypertrophy.
Yeah.
Okay? So in morphology, what you will see, there will be variation in fiber size due to presence of both small and enlarged. Some fibers will be small, some will be enlarged. Increased number of nuclei, degeneration, necrosis and phagocytosis of muscle fibers, regeneration of muscle fibers and proliferation of endomysium. These are the features of both Dukin and Becker.
Okay.
Like this you will see. Okay. This is the cut section, like the transverse section. If you take a transverse section of skeletal muscle in Dukin muscular dystrophy, you will see. In this, you can observe all the fibers are not uniform. So whenever the fibers is not uniform, muscle fiber, it is called variable size. Some are big, some are small. So this is variation in muscle fiber size. Increase endomysial connective tissue. You can see here, this is the connective tissue. Okay? Normally, the connective tissue will be very thin. Okay? You know the covering of the muscle fibers. So only that covering is the connective tissue. It is very thin. So in Dukin you can see there is increased connective tissue. All this is connective tissue. Okay? And I told you, there is, whenever there is any problem like this, the macrophages, they will come. So this is nothing but, here there are no macrophages. These are the nuclei only. These are all internalized nuclei. There are no macrophages.
Dystrophin protein in the muscle contraction.
Dystrophin, it will form a link between the intracellular cytoskeleton, actin and all. I show you this diagram. See this. This is an actin, cytoplasmic actin. Okay. I think in histology they just mentioned actin, it will grow on the myosin and muscle contracts.
Yes.
But if you go in depth, you will see dystrophin will play a role. Mm-hmm. It forms an interface between this and this.
Yeah.
If it is, there is mutation, any problem in dystrophin, this actin and myosin, they can't work properly. Okay?
This mutation.
Is, yeah. Because of mutation in dystrophin. So at your level, you just remember dystrophin is a protein, and in Dukin muscular dystrophy, there is mutation in this protein. Okay? Because the other details is not required, how it affects. But it affects because the problem is there in this, because of this there is smooth contraction of muscle, it does not occur. What is this? Did you see like this image any time? This is called Western blot.
Yes.
You know? Western blot. Western blot, actually this test is done to check in hemoglobin also. This is usually done in sickle cell anemia like this, or this is done to check the presence of proteins, you know, albumin, globulin, like that. Dystrophin is also a protein, so they will check that protein by this method. So in this leukin, this dystrophin is absent here, absence of dystrophin. Mutation means it's not necessary there should be dystrophin. Dystrophin can be absent. So in leukin it is absent, and in Becker it is altered. Okay, so both are mutations only because of these mutations. So in one it is absent and in other it is altered, and this is the normal one. So normal, if you take a graph, so what they will do, they will take these proteins, and one agar plate is there, so they will apply this here and it will move like this. If protein is there in that, it will take a band like this. For example, if they apply it from here, so it forms a band like this here. So if it is normal, it will appear like this, and if it is abnormal, it will appear only a single band, and if it is absent, there is no band. So DMD stands for leukin. In leukin it is absent, in Becker it is altered, and this is the normal. Is it clear?
Yes.
This is the clinical features. Boys, I told you, females are carriers, so males are affected. So boys with leukin are normal at birth. So once they start walking, the mother, she will observe. Because in leukin and in Becker, what will happen is, if the patient is allowed to sit, he will not stand properly. If we sit, we can easily stand up. So these leukin patients, if they sit with great difficulty, they will stand, because the muscles, they will not support for contraction. We are standing immediately. Why? Because the muscles are contracting immediately and we are easily standing. So these patients, they are allowed to stand, it's very difficult for them to stand. Okay? So weakness begins in the pelvic girdle. Pelvic girdle means this part. This whole is called pelvic girdle. So these muscles are affected first. Okay? If this is in correct position, the patient can stand properly. If it is not in correct position, if it is very weak, the patient, he will do like this, like this. Okay? It's very difficult for him to stand properly. So weakness begins in pelvic girdle and then extends to shoulder girdle. This is called shoulder girdle. This is called pelvic girdle. Enlargement of muscles of lower leg associated with weakness, a phenomenon termed pseudo-hypertrophy. Pseudo-hypertrophy means, for example, any weightlifter or any muscular person is there, so his muscles will be very hypertrophy, but it is due to his exercise. Okay? But here, this is due to abnormality. This is due to mutations in gene. Because of that, there is hypertrophy of muscles. And there is hypertrophy, but those muscles are very weak. So it is called pseudo-hypertrophy. And this is a very important clinical finding. If you see any patient with hypertrophied muscles, with enlarged muscles, but the patient is very weak, means that is muscular dystrophy. Cognitive impairment is related to CNS. So Deakin is clear?
Yes.
Any doubt?
Thank you.
Only remember few things. Mutation in dystrophin. There will be variation in muscle fibers. They can be hypertrophy, they can be atrophy. In between there is increased connective tissue. Okay? Necrosis, all these things. These are this is the morphology. Clinically, deep neck starts with pelvic girdles
shoulder
and ascends up to shoulder girdle. Okay? And pseudo-hypertrophy. These 2 points is enough in clinical. Pseudo-hypertrophy and weakness. That's all. Leukin and Becker both. Okay. Second thing is inflammatory myopathies. What do you mean by inflammatory myopathies? It is due to inflammation. Inflammation is because of 2 reasons. One is infectious and second is
non-infectious.
Non-infectious. Without infection also there is inflammation. What is the example?
For infection.
Without infection.
Without infection there is inflammation. No, no. Immune, any immune condition, not necessary, yeah, autoimmune. Not necessarily there is infection, but there will be inflammation. So here in this group, only in your objective, non-infectious is important. Non-infectious inflammatory myopathies. That means there is no infection here. No bacteria, no virus, nothing. So it is non-infectious inflammatory myopathies. So definitely it will be immune-mediated. Whenever it is non-infectious means immune-mediated. Immune-mediated and characterized by injury and inflammation of skeletal muscle.
So autoimmune disease?
Autoimmune, there will be inflammation.
Without infection?
Yeah, without infection. So these are the three groups, dermatomyositis, polymyositis, inclusion body myositis. Okay?
So is there a more thing of immune or just antibody?
No, here it is antibody.
Just antibody.
Yeah, yeah. Non-infectious. So dermatomyositis, it is an inflammatory disorder of skin as well as skeletal muscle. Dermatomyositis, the name itself is telling. Dermato means skin. Myo means skeletal muscle. Itis means
inflammation.
So inflammation of skin and skeletal muscle. So it is characterized by distinctive skin rash, and that rash takes the form of lilac or heliotrop. What do you mean by lilac?
There is no lilac.
Lilac. You know pink?
Yes.
Yeah, it is almost pinkish. Pinkish lilac. Color is called lilac. So if you just see the patient, you will see this is dermatomyositis. Pinkish or dark pink it is. And it appears on upper eyelid and periorbital edema. Muscle weakness is slow in onset, bilaterally symmetric and accompanied by myalgias. Myalgias means pain. Pain in the muscle. Whenever you have any viral fever sometimes, you will have pain in the body. You will feel pain, fever and pain and running nose in upper respiratory also. Pain all over the body. That is myalgia. You will have pain all over the body. That is due to viral infection. So here in dermatomyositis, it is, there is weakness, myalgias and bilaterally symmetric. And affects the proximal muscles. What do you mean by proximal muscles? For example, this is arm. So in this, which one is proximal, which one is distal? The above one. This one is, the arm is proximal. This is distal. So in our body, any group of muscle, it is divided into two. I think the histology people, they told you. Proximal and distal. So in dermatomyositis, the problem starts from proximal. In Deakin, the problem starts from peripheral. You have seen that. First in the... So it is... The proximal muscles are affected first, then it will transfer like this. So lilac color rash, lilac rash, periorbital edema. This is the affection on skin. And the muscle weakness is proximal, slow in onset, bilaterally symmetric. For example, if the upper, this upper limb is affected, so first it will affect the both arms. If legs are affected, first it will affect both thighs. Okay? This is called bilateral and symmetric. So this is the morphology. This is lilac color. Yeah, you can see here. There is edema and reddish. Here it is reddish, but it is not like this. It can be more purple type. So this is the skin rash, periorbital edema. It is called heliotrop rash affecting the eyelids. What you are seeing here? Muscle fibers. The muscle bundle is called fascicle. You know? So the muscle will be in bundle, arranged in bundles. So each bundle is covered by a connective tissue. What do you call that?
Fissure.
Yeah. So usually it is very thin. So what you are seeing here? It is very thick. Okay? So this is called, see, the histologic appearance of muscle shows perifascicular atrophy of muscle fibers and inflammation. This is one bundle. Can you see here? This is one bundle. This is one bundle. This is one bundle. What you are seeing here?
No.
What is the difference between these two?
Atrophy.
Very good. So there is atrophy of muscle fibers. Whenever there is atrophy, there will be some only definitely connective tissue deposition because the space will not be empty. Okay? So this is the connective tissue deposition, this is atrophic fibers, and these are the dots. What are these dots? All these are chronic inflammatory cells, lymphocytes and macrophages. Okay. And what is this?
Fibers.
This is one muscle fiber. Inside that you are seeing one clear vacuole. And inside the vacuole there is something pinkish. This is called inclusion body. Okay. Inclusion means something is entering inside. That is called inclusion body. For example, this is first year class. If some outside person is entering here, he is inclusion body because this is not his place. Okay? So this is called inclusion body. So just by name it is called inclusion body myositis because in this there is inclusion bodies and because of this inclusion body there is myositis. So these are the dermatomyositis, polymyositis and inclusion body myositis, these are three non-infectious inflammatory muscular disorders. Is it clear?
Clear.
So this is, you have to remember these three things. One is periorbital edema, skin rash, muscular atrophy and inflammatory cells. And here there is inclusion body.
This is
the lilac. Yeah, lilac. This is lilac or heliotrope, both are same. This is LILAC, L-I-L-A-C. Okay, you can write here LILAC. Polymyositis, symmetrical proximal muscle involvement. It differs from dermatomyositis by lack of cutaneous. That means in polymyositis, the name itself is suggesting there is no skin involvement. In dermatomyositis, there is rash. In polymyositis, there is no rash. And inclusion body myositis, the other two, dermatomyositis, polymyositis have proximal involvement. And inclusion body it has distal. That's all. Just remember this. And the weakness is asymmetric. These two, it will have the differentiating factors. Okay? Is it clear? These three, dermatomyositis, skin rash, lilac color, periorbital edema, and No. In dermatomyositis, there is muscular atrophy and inflammatory cells. This is dermatomyositis. Polymyositis, same as dermatomyositis without skin involvement. Okay? Inclusion body myositis, there is inclusion body and distal muscles are. Is it clear? Last is diseases of neuromuscular junction. What do you mean by neuromuscular junction?
Process.
This facet is controlled by a nerve fiber. The junction where the nerve is entering the muscle is called neuromuscular junction. And I think in physiology and anatomy they have discussed it. What is the normal thing? So here we will discuss what is the problem there that happens in myasthenia. So you have to know about two diseases here. One is myasthenia gravis and second thing is Eaton-Lambert. So myasthenia gravis, it is immune mediated.
Syndrome.
Eaton-Lambert syndrome. Yeah, Eaton-Lambert syndrome. So myasthenia gravis is autoimmune disease. Autoimmune disease means antibodies are
accumulation.
So these antibodies are present against the receptors. Very good. It is against the receptors. Those receptors are acetylcholine receptors. Acetyl. So it is caused by immune mediated loss of acetylcholine receptors. So and autoantibodies are raised against the acetylcholine receptors. Thymic hyperplasia is found in 65% and thymoma is present in 15%. So this is an association. Thymoma and thymic. Where is thymus?
Yeah. Above of the heart?
It is
above of the heart?
Gland which is seen in which age group? Yeah, it is present in children. With age it regresses. So if you see any myasthenia gravis patient, those patients they have this hyperplasia or the cancer of thymoma. So autoantibodies, so this is the pathogenesis. Autoantibodies against the acetylcholine receptors lead to loss of functional
receptors.
So this is clear. Antibodies, they act on the receptors. So how they act? It is by these three different methods. Fixing complement and direct injury, increasing the internalization and degradation of receptors, and inhibiting binding of acetylcholine. By these three pathways, they will lead to loss of receptors. Okay? Increasing the internalization and degradation. What will happen? The receptors, they will not allow these receptors to go here and there. They are concentrated there at the neuromuscular junction, and on those receptors the antibodies act. So they can act by direct injury or by inhibiting binding of acetylcholine. Okay? Morphology by light microscopy, muscle biopsy. By light microscopy, what do you mean by light microscopy? Did you see the microscope?
Yes.
In our lab? That is called light microscope. Because we are using light source. So if you see under the light, in this microscope, you will see nothing. The muscle fibers, they appear normal. So by light microscopic, the muscle biopsy specimens are unrevealing. In severe cases, atrophy due to disuse. Disuse means the patient is unable to use the muscle, because of that there is atrophy. Electron microscope, the postsynaptic membrane is simplified and there is loss of acetylcholine receptors. Okay? Why there is loss of acetylcholine receptors? Because the antibodies, they are degraded. Okay? They act on these receptors, and whenever they act on the receptors, they degrade them. Okay? Immune complexes and complement membrane attack complex can be found along the postsynaptic membrane. Why this is found? Anyone? Immune complexes and complement membrane. Yeah, this is because we have discussed this is an autoimmune process. Whenever there is immune process, there will be immune complexes as well as the complement also will play a role. How the complement will play? In inflammation, we have discussed this. Membrane attack complex and all these things. Okay? So they will form a complement membrane attack complex, and these are present along the postsynaptic membrane. So for this reason, I am telling you repeatedly, inflammation is very important. Anywhere in the body, if you are not clear in inflammation, you will get confused here. If you are clear in inflammation, mediators of inflammation, all these things, this will be very easy for you. Okay? Even if you don't read also, you can blindly write, because inflammation anywhere in the body it will be same. Complement anywhere in the body it will be same. So you again read this. This is very important. Okay? So immune complexes and complement membrane attack complex is found along the postsynaptic membrane. This pathogenesis is clear?
Yes.
Okay? Is there any doubt? This is very important. Myasthenia gravis. Okay, you should remember this. Functional loss of acetylcholine receptor by antibodies. Okay, next comes the clinical course. Weakness begins with extraocular muscles. You know, around our eyeball is moving because of extraocular muscles.
Yeah.
Extraocular muscles, drooping of eyelids. It is called ptosis. P is silent, it's ptosis. Ptosis means?
Dropping eyelid.
Yeah. We are opening our eyes because?
Weakness of the muscle.
No. Normal opening is due to which muscle?
Orthobiolus.
Orthobiolus, very good. It is. So that muscle, if it is weak, then the patient, he will close his eyes. And the person who is seeing him, he thinks that he is sleeping. He is not sleeping. This is his problem, because he is unable to open the eyelids. Okay, that is called drooping of eyelid, ptosis, and diplopia. What do you mean by diplopia? Double vision. cause the affected individual to seek medical attention. Initial symptoms may take the form of generalized weakness. Patient shown improvement in strength in response to administration of anticholinesterase. Did the pharmacology people discuss this?
Yes.
Anticholinesterase.
Yeah.
What is the function of this?
Degradation of acetylcholine.
Inhibit, yeah, very good. It inhibits?
Acetylcholine.
What are the drugs?
Nystagmine.
Nystagmine, all this. So they will inhibit the acetylcholine degradation so that it is available in the? Yeah, yeah. So I think all these they have discussed, no need to. So the patient, he gets improved in response to administration of anticholinesterase. Effective treatment include anticholinesterase drugs. Prednisone, plasmapheresis. What is plasmapheresis?
Like dialysis.
Yeah, very good. It is like dialysis.
Like dialysis, yeah.
In dialysis, what you are doing? You are removing the toxins of the kidney. In plasmapheresis, what you are doing? You are removing antibodies. So it is plasmapheresis and thymectomy. When thymic lesions are present, this is the treatment. Anticholinesterase, prednisone, plasmapheresis. So clinical course, it begins with extraocular muscles, ptosis, and diplopia. Okay. Lambert-Eaton myasthenic syndrome. It is related to myasthenia gravis. That means it is a disease of neuromuscular junction. But it is different from neuromuscular. First is it can be paraneoplasty. What is paraneoplasty? Symptoms which are not explained by the hormones released by the tumor. For example, kidney secretes erythropoietin. Okay? If any kidney cancer is secreting erythropoietin, that is normal. Okay? If lung cancer is secreting erythropoietin, that is abnormal. And that is paraneoplastic. Paraneoplastic means the symptoms which are not explained. Okay? So the same thing is here, the paraneoplastic small cell carcinoma, it secretes that. Okay? It can occur in absence of underlying malignant disease. Affected individual. See, small cell carcinoma, it should secrete the hormones related to lung. Okay? Hormones or any chemical. If it is secreting any antibodies or if it is causing myasthenia gravis or Eaton-Lambert syndrome, that is abnormal because actually it is immune mediated. It is paraneoplastic syndrome. Affected individual develop proximal muscle weakness and autonomic dysfunction. So what is the difference between Lambert-Eaton and myasthenia? First is no clinical improvement by anticholinesterase agent. And electrophysiologic studies show evidence of enhanced neurotransmission with repetitive stimulation. In myasthenia, if you stimulate repetitive, the weakness will improve. Here, the patient, he will improve. See this, enhanced neurotransmission with repetitive stimulation. See, in myasthenia, whenever the patient, he does more work, the weakness will improve. Whereas here, if he does more work, the strength will improve. Okay? From weakness, he will come. So both are opposite to each other. If you give anticholinesterase in myasthenia, the condition improves. Here, the condition will not improve. So you just remember myasthenia, right opposite for Lambert-Eaton. Okay? Content of anticholinesterase is normal in neuromuscular junction. These are the differences between myasthenia and Lambert-Eaton. Postsynaptic membrane is normally responsive to anticholinesterase, but fewer vesicles are released in response to each presynaptic action potential. Just in differences, you just mentioned these two. This is enough. Okay, no clinical improvement and repetitive stimulation will increase the strength. Thank you. Any doubt?
Hello.